This program is brought to you by thepodcastfactory.com.
How would you like to get more customers, make more profits, and have bigger breakthroughs? Get Doberman Dan's profit-boosting breakthroughs. Normally, this would cost you $98 per month, but right now, for listening to this show, he's giving you a free copy of his Doberman Dan letter. All you have to do is go to DobermanDan.com and sign up to get your free copy now.
Prepare yourself for the uncensored, nothing held back, no BS reality of how business and life really work. Doberman Dan is off the chain.
What is happening? So good to see everybody here in the canine crew. And JR, aka Jonation, aka Jonathan. What's going on, brother?
Dude, I want to look. I'm supposed to be rebranding myself and reinventing. I want to be Jonation next.
I like it. I like what my initial nom de plume for you has morphed into.
It's better than the original, for sure.
Well, yeah, the original had some negative stuff with the backstory. I got into it now. I just got to tell a story and then we'll move on to the real stuff. So back when I was a street cop, some very colorful dude named Jonathan was a snitch, and he preferred to be called Joe Nathan. It's spelled Jonathan, but he preferred to be called Joe Nathan. And so now when we first met, that was just what came to mind. It's like, Jonathan Rivera. Okay, Joe Nathan.
With the affect. You had a little affect on it every time you said it. You've forgotten that. That's okay.
All right. So it has morphed into something different. It is now your own. There's no drug addict slash
snitch.
Cop snitch backstory to it. You're Joe Nation. You're your own dude making things happen, writing the script of your own life. Speaking of writing.
Yeah, there we go.
Exactly. Speaking of writing scripts and writing the scripts of your life, which we were just talking about, especially talking about the little picture that's right behind me that you can't see right now. Just take my word for it. It's just like a big pen and it says write, spelled W-R-I-T-E, by the way. That's what makes things happen in my world. And that's what makes things happen in Dustin Matthews' world, too. Who is with us today? Dustin, what's going on, buddy?
Hey, I'm thrilled to be here. But, I want to say I want a cool AKA. And I was trying to think. And the only thing I could come up with is like a French guy saying my name, like Dustin. Dustin.
Oh, now that sounds good. Can you do it with the accent, though?
I thought that was my accent. Dustin. There we go. Is that better?
Well, okay. Just to be totally transparent with you.
It takes some time.
Yeah, you sound like a gringo trying to do the French accent.
I love it.
But I like it. Dustin. It sounds very sophisticated.
Joe Nathan, that's pretty creative, but I'll work on it.
Dustin. You know, I was thinking today back to when we first met. Francis Ablola, a mutual friend and also a guy who writes the script of his own life, introduced us at a Ted Nicholas event, right?
Was it that? Yeah. Yeah.
Or was it before? It was. I don't think it was before that. I mean, of course, I've heard about you for a long time and heard some crazy stories about you, which we'll get into.
Ooh.
And I'm making that up. I really haven't. But yeah, I think that was the first time we met. And you're one of those guys that you're just likable, man. Just from the minute I met you, and we only hung out for a brief period at that seminar when we first met, but I'm like, yeah, this guy gets it. This guy's cool. I can talk with this guy.
Well, thank you, sir. I appreciate it. I was going to peg it as I do remember that seminar. I was going to peg it as a Dan Kennedy seminar or GKIC sort of deal, but yeah, I think you're spot on. Yeah. Cause Francis was there. Yeah. Well, I appreciate the kind words, and that's just how I roll, you know? Yeah.
Well, you have thousands of people who love you and your partner, Dave Van Hoos, in a business I'm fascinated with. And I'd just like you to, Well, I want to talk about that. But first, I always like to find out how in the world do people find their way into this crazy direct marketing / online marketing thing? Nobody, I've yet to meet anybody who's in it or there's a copywriter who says, well, ever since I was a kid, I just wanted to be a copywriter. So I want to hear how you stumbled into this world.
Yeah. You know, I'm the same way too. Like I'm real fascinated like with the history of stuff. Like, you know, I'm in the seminar speaking sort of business and, you know, I love the history of it. Like when guys primarily were writing on chalkboards and the old adage was, and let me know if you've heard this, but the guy that had the most chalk on his suit ended up selling the most. And, you know, like you don't hear that nowadays because no one uses a chalkboard, but I'm real fascinated. So I appreciate the ask of the story there. I read Rich Dad, Poor Dad. You read that one?
Oh, yes. Well, that goes back a ways. But that interesting. Now, you're one of many people who said that kind of started them on an interesting path. So tell me more.
Well, wait a minute. I just have to ask because it's kind of weird for me. I've been doing a lot of podcasts because I got the book out. But Doberman Dan, there's you. And then there's Joe Nathan. Do I address both of you or only one of you? Like, how does this go?
either or, whichever of us you find more interesting and are bonding with. And if it's Joe Nation, trust me, I'm not going to be offended. I'll just shut my big trap and listen.
So like basically the collective you or the collective we.
The board. That's right. Oh, can I interject something?
Of course.
It's a pet peeve of mine. And I catch people doing this in writing. I catch people doing this on websites, in books. I've caught major authors doing this. And I hear so many people doing this on webinars. When they talk to their listener, a key word there, listener, singular, they always say, hey, you guys, got something special for you guys. Or, you know, you guys may have experienced this. No, I mean, when I write something and when I'm on my webinar, I'm talking to one person. This is it's a relationship thing. This is like me, you know, knocking on your door, sitting out at your kitchen table with you over a cup of coffee, and I'm talking to you, the listener. So that's my pet peeve. If I've screwed up and ever said you guys, then, you know, send me to podcasting purgatory or whatever. But so you can address either me or Joe Nation, and you can use his real name if you want to, Jonathan, which now seems so boring.
Passé.
I love it.
But when, please, just a favor, Dustin, when you're addressing my dear listener, again, singular, whom we are chatting with, please address them as a singular person. We're not talking to you guys. And you know what's so funny about me blabbing on about that is you're in the speaking business, dude. I'm just preaching to the choir, aren't I?
You totally are. And because, you know, sometimes when one gets up on stage, when I get up on stage, now I'm thinking about it, which is going to make for one hilarious episode. When you're on stage, sometimes you just get excited and your mind races so fast that I have seen myself say you all or you. I usually don't say you guys because I don't know why, but maybe the pet peeve is there, but I will catch myself and I know it gets out of my mouth before I can actually say, correct it. And so it'll come off as you all. How many of you would like this? You know, I might ask a question. And so I almost feel like Doberman Dan and Joe Nathan, Joe Nation, I need a, I need a buzzer, you know, like a, you know, Pavlovian, you know, dog. So like, that would be pretty cool, right? Like if you had the buzzer over there and every time I said you guys were a host, you know, you had it and you could buzz me. Wouldn't that be fun?
Oh, I love it. That would be fun. Here's the reverse of that though, which may not be so fun. I think the same should be applied to me. Like if I ever say you guys, but the one I should probably be buzzed for all the, and Jonathan will back me up on this, for all the ums and you knows and likes. When I read the transcriptions, I read it and I'm thinking, oh my dear God, I can't believe I'm saying that so often. You know, well, luckily the transcriptionist doesn't transcribe but yeah, the buzzer thing. So if we're going to buzz you, then we need to buzz me on all those annoying things that I do.
Fair enough.
So we want to find, yeah, exactly. So, you know, like we want to find out how you got into this strange, weird world of
yes.
online marketing / direct marketing / copywriting, yada, yada, / entrepreneurship.
Let's do it. I started with Rich Dad Poor Dad. And so I thought I was going to be the next real estate millionaire. I went down to an investor club where people were using all these foreign terminologies to me because I had never invested in real estate. And they were saying, I got a 4-3 on block and, you know, in South Tampa for sale for 119K. And kind of remind me of what I envisioned the stock market to be, you know, when they were trading and yelling across the floor, selling stocks and, you know, buying stocks. And I walked into that environment and I basically just mimicked the book and said, well, you know, go find my rich dad. So go find a mentor. And so Dave, my partner now in this business, Speaking Empire, he was starting a little startup company called foreclosuresdaily.com. And I said, listen, teach me how to buy a house and I'll work for free. And so he's like, oh, free labor. Of course I'll take this. And so he did. And so I was his like Dallas Friday. What's the equivalent of that in a male term?
Okay. I have to reveal my ignorance now, which to be honest with you, I'm ignorant about pretty much damn near everything. I don't get the Dallas Friday reference. Enlighten me.
Oh, Dallas Friday. Well, I think Girl Friday is what I meant to say. Where did Dallas come from?
I don't know, but you invented something cool. I'm thinking, that's probably from a book I should have read.
He's baiting us. Open loop. NLP trickery coming up.
No, that was like a slip of the mind, Freudian. So I don't know where I don't know where Dallas came from. Maybe it's in my head or someone said it to me today. Girl Friday. So what's the equivalent of a Girl Friday, which is like an assistant?
The Dude Friday.
Okay, I'll roll with that. So I was like Dave's Dude Friday. And I would basically send emails to get people to show up at seminars. And so really my foray into this world, or like the first sort of good memory, it was picking up a Kennedy book and I read The Ultimate Sales Letter. And that's when I figured out we can put words on paper and get people to do stuff. You know, and if you can imagine me like holding my fingers together, you know, ruffling my fingers together, that's what I'm doing. Cause that's my mindset. I was like, holy crap, we can put words on paper and get people to give us money. We can get donate to a charity. We can get them to call. We can get them to show up. And so I had never taken this at school. I went to school to become a computer nerdy techie guy. Well, actually, I was already a nerdy techie guy, but I just went to school for that as well to add on to my nerdiness. And I never took business or marketing in school. And so when I found out about copywriting via Kennedy, I said, oh man, this is really cool. And so I've been fascinated ever since, like this idea of psychology to get people into action by words on paper, words into a microphone, speaking on a stage, webinar, whatever your media is, it's pretty powerful. Obviously, Dan, I'm preaching to the choir here. Like you get that. And so you have the nation here. You've got Camelot. And so I'm speaking to the choir. But when I first came across this, it was like magic to me. And so that's kind of my foray into this, was picking up his book and testing all these cool, fascinating direct response copywriting ideas at this startup company.
Well, I get all your stuff. I'm on your list because I'm just like that. I just like getting good marketing. Plus, one of these days, I will come to an event. I keep saying that, but yes. I actually will leave my house, which is something I rarely do anymore, and come to an event. But I get your stuff, and it's really, really good. I admire your writing ability. Oh, and I slipped up. I should have called you Sir Dustin of Matthews because you are a knight in my Marketing Camelot. Completely shameless plug there at marketingcamelot.com. But I love you for that. And I appreciate you being a knight in the Marketing Camelot.
Absolutely. I like that. Sir Dustin of Matthews. I'm going to roll with that for a while.
Yeah, I like that too. So that's interesting. I never knew how you met Dave. So, by the way, Dave Van Hoos has been on the show. And we got some really good feedback because he talked basically about the personal journey he's on right now and how that applies to, you know, not just this life, but applies to business and everything too. So that's cool. I did not know you met Dave that way. So how did that turn into Speaking Empire, the business you guys are running now?
That's a good one. So I was at the company and I was there. I became director of marketing because no one understood marketing. Everyone was a sales guy over there. And so I put this letter together on goldenrod paper. I think back, it's hilarious. Goldenrod paper. I downloaded a handwriting font and I sent a letter to all these customers that we had already had, existing customers, because that's what I learned. And they were the easiest people to sell. And so I couldn't take a phone call. I was introverted and couldn't get on the phone and sell. And so I drove them to a salesperson. And so that person became my new best friend because she no longer had to make cold calls. This direct response letter got her phone ringing off the hook. And so she started making sales and money. And I said, oh, this is pretty cool. And so what ended up happening, I became director of marketing in a short amount of time. We did a lot of stuff there. But I got to tell you, having all those gurus come in, like, you can do this and you can be the next real estate millionaire. You know, it was motivating in one sense, but it was demotivating because I'm like, I don't really want to do real estate, but it got me charged up. And I said, you know what? I got to go be my own man. I got to go figure this out. I got to go become a guru. And so I left. I put my 2 weeks in and I stumbled into a mastermind. I volunteered there using my old rich dad, poor dad strategy of just volunteering to work for free. And essentially what happened was this mastermind was being put on. It was all the alpha male. And I say alpha male because you got to have a healthy sense of ego in the real estate space. It was pretty much dominated by all men. And these are all real estate speakers, big bravados and big ego. And so I stumbled into this mastermind and the facilitator says, listen, these folks, you know, have been invited. They haven't paid. So we need to monetize this. Obviously we want to sell them in a mastermind, but you know, why don't you sell them some of your marketing copywriting stuff? And I said, okay, great. I'll do it. And you got to imagine, I was so nervous because these guys were trained assassins. And here I was, I had to give a pitch to the, like, you know, the legends of the field. And so I did. And what I learned was it didn't matter how good I was. It was just, I had an irresistible offer. They were all making lots of money and they knew they had this pain, which was none of them had really good marketing. And so what I did was I said, hey, I'm going to do your copywriting, your promotion. So when you go out and speak, more people will actually be there so you can make more money. And I'm going to put it on a website. That was my techie. And so I built this website for them and I started selling. And so what ended up happening, long story short, I would go and sell this. The real estate market tanked. And Dave said, I need to reinvent myself. And so Speaking Empire was born because Dave said, let's do a seminar in 30 days and fill all the people that we know, invite them, and let's sell something. And so Speaking Empire was born at a seminar.
Wow. In a 30-day, you launched that in a 30-day time. Well, at least you launched your first seminar in 30 days.
Oh, yeah. Let me tell you that conversation real quick because you know Dave and you've had him on. So Dave is the consummate sales guy. So we're sitting on the dock of the bay, really, like Tampa Bay. We're in a condo complex. Dave sells me on like, hey, you should buy a house condo here. So I did. And so he's walking down the dock. He sees me and he's like, hey, come over here. I need to reinvent myself. I need to make some money. And I said, okay, what do you want to do? He's like, all right, let's do a seminar in 30 days. And I'm like, Dave, you don't understand. I'm a marketing guy. I want 6 months. Like, I want a window. And he's like, no, you don't understand. We need to do this in 30 days. So I said, oh, we're negotiating here. All right, do 3 months. And so I told him 3 months. And he said, no, 30 days. And so I came back to him and I tried to get 60 days. And we ended up doing it in 31 days. And so we invited everybody we knew. I did some direct mail. They picked up the phone and called people. I did some email. We got them in a room. We did everything wrong, but we got one client that gave us $25,000. And so the speaker makeover, that was the name of the first event, was born.
Nice. Yeah, 31 days. You know, when he said 30 days, my first thought would have been, dude, I need at least that to write the copy. I mean, come on. Wow. So I'm fascinated by this business, you know, and you and I have talked about this before. So I'm so tempted sometimes to start speaking myself, like speaking on stages. And of course, I mean, you and Dave are the go-to guys for that. You've got, you know, a mountain of success stories. You've had some of the best stage speakers in the world come to you guys for this makeover. You craft the whole deal for them. And then, I mean, like, they're off and rocking and rolling. How do you do that? What do you, you don't have to reveal any, you know, proprietary secrets, but when somebody says, hey man, yeah, set me up with that speaker makeover deal, what do you do for them?
I feel like when you said you don't have to reveal any proprietary information, I feel like, you know, you see on TV and the government has like a report and it's all redacted. And so like there's an and or a the. So we're going to redact some of this. I'm just kidding. So it's a process, just like when you have copywriting, you know, when you go through it, it's second nature to you now. But if you were to deconstruct it, it's a process. And so we do a lot of prep work ahead of time. And I'll tell you what's interesting is we actually make the client do a lot of the work. And so we send out a crazy, ridiculous questionnaire to them that actually gets them to think and come up with answers. It gives them demonstration, it gives them examples, and they will actually go through and fill out copywriting. Essentially, they will write bullet points for each slide. That's how much we've gotten it down to. And then obviously when they come here and they see us here at Speaking Empire, we work on refining it. We work on having them present it here. And so it's really about polishing. And so they get, you know, prep materials. There's work that goes in ahead of time. And then they come here and they actually have to deliver it. So, I think of it like an assembly line process where we're just asking questions. And to go back even further, I guess before to even really answer that, we've just basically, like, you have a copywriting formula, we have a speaking formula. And so everything's so formulaic because most people, when they start, they need the formula, they need it spelled out step by step. And then once you get great, like, obviously you can break those norms, you can deviate, you know, because you've got your own voice now. And so just like as a copywriter, I think of the same thing we do, Dan, is it's the same thing. Like, you're writing words on paper, you're training people to be better wordsmiths. We do that too, but it's spoken word versus written word.
You know, what I find interesting is that your clients, they've got the answers they need already, and they understand how to present their thang, whatever that thang is. But without you, I mean, it's like buried somewhere deep in the recesses of that squishy gray matter. And through your process, you just draw it out. I find that fascinating because I've had people pay me money to help them with their marketing. And what that consists of sometimes is us sitting down face to face in Orlando, Florida for the whole day. And there are days that I feel like, man, I didn't really do much. Right. All I did was ask a bunch of questions. And these people come away from that day with these major breakthroughs, you know, like that completely transform their business. And sometimes I feel like, geez, I mean, you know, they just solved their own problem. I just kind of facilitated.
Two things there. Thank you, Socrates, right? Socratic method, just asking questions. So thank you, sir. Second thing is, you said Orlando. You don't make them to come see you in Ocala?
You know, that is so funny you should say that. It's so inconvenient to get here. Like, from anywhere, it's easy to get to Orlando, you know, and it's only a 90-minute drive for me. But I guess if I really, really wanted to do the guru at the top of the mountain thing, you know, I'll make them rent a car and come to me in little Ocala.
Come on, Dan. He doesn't want people to know where he's at for real.
I don't. You know what? The lovely Colombiana, it's a cultural thing. We won't go into the reasons why, but is very guarded. If you think I'm guarded about my privacy, you should see her. Ain't nobody we don't know coming to our house finding out where we live. So Dan Kennedy does that, though. You have to fly to Cleveland, Ohio, yep. And then hang out at his house. And it's actually pretty brilliant, man. It's like the wise man isn't at the bottom of the mountain, easy to get to, you know? So good point on that, Dustin.
Well, I was curious. It was either that or you just really love Mickey. I was kind of leaning towards Mickey, but I like that reason too.
So this is interesting. The way you got into this, I want to go back to you talking about finding a rich dad. I really get tired of people who whine about their situations and then aren't willing to go change it. One of my close friends recently did that. He just made the decision because he's 52. He's too old to get hired or find a job or anything. And of course, I disputed that and shot that down. but that was the decision he made in his mind. So that became his reality. And what you did is you just decided, well, I just need to find somebody to show me the way. And I guess to make that happen, I'm going to offer to work for free. How often do you hear about that? Like, you're a go-getter, man. Hardly anybody does that.
Well, you know, I read the book and I took action. And so I immediately put myself, you know, I believe he introduced this idea that, you know, people get together in these meetings, these associations or these clubs. And so I researched, I took action. I researched and I was extremely intimidated to go down there. I remember being incredibly nervous going there because, like, who am I? And, you know, I didn't know. And so I go in there and they were yelling this foreign language. And the story goes, there was about 300. This was in the real estate heyday. So there were 300 people it was the Sheraton, I think, at the time. Sheraton Hotel. No, Doubletree. It was the Doubletree Hotel in Tampa. And I remember, like, going into that room and I was so nervous and intimidated, I retreated. And so I'm like, man, how am I going to find my rich dad if we're going to stay on that theme? And I'm like, oh, there's a vendor area over here. And so this is a good lesson for folks that want to find friends, quick friends. If people won't speak to you in the room itself because they're there to do business, well, go find people that want to sell you something. And so that's what I did was I retreated to the vendor area and I just went from booth to booth. And of course, they wanted to talk to me and be my friend because, you know, they wanted to sell me something. And so that's when I met Dave there and I said, listen, hey, I'm fresh out of school. And, you know, just it happened to be I put myself in the environment. I would have never thought that there would have been a guy that had just started a company that was essentially, you know, he wanted to sell some stuff, but he also wanted free labor. And so I gave him the pitch. I sold him and said, listen, let me do some stuff for free for you. I know how to use a computer. And Dave, you know, is a consummate sales guy, not very good on the computer at all. And so it was like a match made in heaven. But you're absolutely right. You got to take action. And a lot of times that's go do some research and then go put yourself in a crazy, uncomfortable situation. And that's what I did. And you just never know what's going to happen.
Yeah. I mean, look what happened in your case. You're now a partner in a very successful business. You know, that's pretty much exactly what I did with Gary Halbert. What I did was I got on his radar through the mail. I used what he taught in his newsletter, how to get the attention of a player, of a VIP, and turned around and used it on him and just kept sending him these packages with theater, as he calls it. You know, he got a package with, you know, big box O stuff, a special article framed that I wrote about he and I working together. You know, there I am writing the script of my life and writing my future, and sent it to him. And you know, a lot of the things I wrote in that article came to pass. I mean, that's exactly what I did. I found my rich dad. I found my mentor. And I'm actually amazed how few people ever approach me and just say, hey, man, would you mentor me? I mean, they can ask.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, at least they can ask. You might as well ask. Ask somebody. Ask a bunch of people, because eventually you're going to get a yes. I mean, almost everybody gets a no for me. And you know what that is, Dustin?
A not
That's
yet.
That's a test. Yeah, oh. Exactly. Yep. You're right. It's a not yet, because I want to see how bad does this guy want it. And you know what? Hardly anybody ever comes back after that first no. I mean, what you just gave somebody the template or the formula for finding a mentor, finding a rich dad. And look, I guess it turned out pretty good for you, huh?
Oh, man. Just when things were getting good, we have to end this week's episode. But don't you worry, K9 crew, because we will be back next week with part two of the interview with Dustin Matthews. Come on back next time. Hope you enjoyed today's show. K9 crew got a special treat for you, what we are affectionately referring to as the off-the-chain hotline. Tell us you love us. Tell us you hate us. Ask questions. We don't care. Just call 321-424-6043 and give us a piece of your mind. Thanks for listening. And remember, if you want to create rivers of revenue from your existing customers, then the next thing you need to do is go to DobermanDan.com. He's given away a free copy of his $98 per month Doberman Dan letter just for listening to the show. Go to DobermanDan.com now and sign up for your free issue.
This is the PodcastFactory.com.